Hi, everyone. Happy Tuesday. Thanks for your patience. Sorry I'm a little late. A little technical difficulty. So we're good. Hi, Jen. Hi, Mammoth Tile. Thanks for being here. Welcome to Tile Tuesday. Hi, Jamie. I'm going to try and do a better job saying hi for everybody as they come in. Hi, Robert. So I apologize for being a little bit late, a little technical issue, but I'm excited to be here with you guys again for Tile Tuesday. This is David Fatula with Island Stone, and we've put together what I think is an interesting topic for today. I'm looking forward to your feedback and your interaction. Hi, Nadia. Welcome to Tile Tuesday. So what we're going to talk about today is, and I'll repeat this several times as people start to join, is a successful working relationship between the tile setter and the designer homeowner. And this is something that when it was proposed to me as an idea for a topic, I got excited about. I said, I'm a tile setter. I've been a homeowner and had contracted with people to do work. And then as I started to think about it, it's a little bit more complicated than initially you would think. And that's because everybody has a little bit of a different personality. Every tile setter is a little bit different. So today I'm going to speak to my experience as a tile setter and give you kind of some general guidelines that I think would be helpful for the conversation. And hey, Tile Guy 232. And then I'm certainly, if tile setters are on and they want to add something, we're certainly open to that part of the conversation. And as I mentioned, this is going to kind of be just my opinion, and you know what they say about opinions. But what we're going to talk about is a successful working relationship for the tile setter and the homeowner. So I think we have enough people on here. Welcome, Cornerstone, to Tile Tuesday with Dave Fatula from Island Stone. I got four shots of espresso in here, so by the end we should be really going. Hey, Melissa from Avalon Flooring. So, where to start? Successful working relationship with a homeowner, designer, tile setter. So I have had this question a lot over the years is when I talk to my friends, hey, we're going to hire a tile setter. It's not going to be you. But for whatever reason, how do we make sure that we're going to get a good job? And the first thing I always say is the most important thing is having an open, good rapport with the tile setter. And I think that the reason that's important is that if you have an issue, you can't be hesitant to talk to them about that. And hey, Des127, thanks for joining. So finding someone that you're comfortable working with is really the most important thing. I'm going to assume in the beginning of this conversation that the tile setter is qualified to do the work, and we're going to get into that in a minute. But starting with the fact that you're comfortable with them, and I always think it's a good idea to have two or three estimates, two or three conversations, just to see, you know, the difference between the local talent, if you will. Hi, Ann Sachs, New York. So the number one resource, I think, is the point of purchase. So if you're looking for a tile setter to do your installation, and we're generally talking about residential applications here, commercial work is a little bit of a different conversation. There's a little bit of a different process for qualifying the work and qualifying the tile setter. But for primarily residential tile installations or applications, the point of purchase generally has a good working knowledge of who are the qualified tile setters, particularly for the work that you're looking at. So there's a range in work, you know, 4x4 ceramics, a little bit different than high-end glass tile, like the product that Island Stone sells, or cladding, or more complex handmade product. So I think that's the first thing is talk to your point of purchase, see if they have a recommendation to find a tile setter in your area. If they don't, and I think this is a good backup, there are two really good resources. One is the National Tile Contractors Association, and the other is the Ceramic Tile Education Foundation. And we throw around a lot of acronyms in the tile industry, but you know, there's the TCNA, there's ANSI, there's NTCA. So, but we're talking about today are the organizations that support the labor side of the industry, and that's the National Tile Contractors Association and the Ceramic Tile Education Foundation. And the NTCA has been around for a long time. If you're a tile sitter on here and you're not familiar with them, I would encourage you to go online and check them out. They're an excellent organization. They're the ones that really support the labor side of the tile industry. I've been a member for many years. I was a member as a tile setter and then now an associate member, because as a manufacturer, we are not a member as a tile contractor, but we are as the associate member. And I know Avalon's on here today. Avalon's a member. They have a contracting side of their business, and so they're members of the NTCA, and it's an excellent organization, and we need to continue to support them. And when I went to my very first coverings in the beginning of 2000, I had a very limited budget, but I decided to spend $500 on joining the NTCA because the benefits are so great. And I clearly don't get any kickback from them, but I really believe in supporting them. So I would encourage you to join the NTCA and support them. So the NTCA provides a lot of guidance for the tile setter, but they also have a section of their website where there are contractors that they, in your area, that are members of the NTCA. And seeing that a tile setter is a member of the NTCA indicates to me that they're invested in education and knowledge and advancing the craft of installing tile. And that's something that I think is important to support. And then there's the Ceramic Tile Education Foundation, and that's a little bit of a newer organization, but what they do is they qualify tile setters to that they know the proper way to install tile. And it's not, they don't do the training to teach people to be tile setters, but they take existing tile setters and qualify them. And it's something that really was born out of the need to make sure that the tile trade didn't die and that there was qualified labor that we could rely on as manufacturers. And it was really something that labor got together and started this program with the CTEF. And once again, it's a really important organization. You can go there and you can look up in your area and see who the certified tile installers are in your community. And those would be good starting points if, for example, Avalon has an installation division. So you could first check with the point of sale, ask them if they have any recommendations or that they have installers in-house. And if they don't, then you can go and, hi, John, welcome to Instagram with Tile Tuesdays. You can go and start looking up to qualify your installers. Now, that being said, if they're not a member of the NTCA or they're not part of the CTEF, that doesn't mean they're not going to do a good job. Once again, it's important that you qualify them for yourself. So I would ask questions like, are you licensed? Are you insured? Can you provide references? And can I have some, do you have photos of your work? I know as a tile setter, the work that I did, I was proud of it. I had no problem showing people photos of my work. And not every time I went in to bid work was I asked for references, but I was asked on occasion. And that's something that I think as a good tile setter, it's not too hard to do. I think the question is when you're starting out, that's something that I didn't have that repertoire. So I had to fight a little bit when I was a young, new tile setter to get to work. So you have to qualify yourself and build up your base. But, you know, when I was hungry and young, I found a way to do that, because tile setters have to be salespeople. They have to sell their skill set. They have to sell themselves, and they have to build the relationship with the customer. So, but I didn't get every job I bid, certainly. I didn't want every job that I bid, and there were some customers where it just wasn't going to be a good long-term relationship, so we decided they didn't accept my bid, and that was fine too. So once again, you know, it depends on the jurisdiction. Some states, some jurisdictions require licensing, others don't. Some of them are just licenses that says you're allowed to do business there. It doesn't mean that that they know how to do a good job. Insurance, I think, is really important, because anything can happen. You know, everybody makes mistakes, and it's not necessarily the tile setter's fault, but they need some backup to protect your home. And then photos and references, once again, those are all good things to look into. I'm kind of put together some notes before I started, obviously, and wow, this time's going fast today. Started a little bit late, so I may run a little bit over, but we'll try and wrap this up on time. Guidelines on how much it should cost. This is a totally loaded question, and I will never answer that. Because I don't know what it costs to run another person's business. They don't know what it costs to run my business. So in commercial work, labor, unions, there are established rates for tile installation and how much you need to get done during the day. That's all agreed to in advance. But for me, it's not agreed to. And each job is a little bit different. And I would love to be able to tell you it's X number, $50 a square foot for a backsplash. It's $100 a square foot for a steam shower. There are guidelines. I used those references when I was bidding the work. But each job's a little bit different. And I generally bid by the job, not by the square foot. And I can tell you that I did some experiments over the years where I would have the exact same amount of square footage for a backsplash, the exact same number of outlets I had to cut, and I would give the exact same price to two different people, and one person would say, when can you start? And the other person would accuse me of being a thief. And so people's perception of money varies across the board. You guys know that. And it also varies by how busy I am. If I have 8 months of work stacked up, you're not getting my best price. I'm sorry, it's supply and demand. And if you don't like my price, you don't like my price. I personally didn't build in negotiation number. If you wanted it to be for less money, sorry, I get on my soapbox a little here. If you wanted it for less money, we had to change the scope of the work. So, I think often, as we all know, manual labor, blue-collar workers, sometimes don't get paid what they should. So I'm obviously coming at this from the side of a tile setter, not from a designer or homeowner who's trying to contract the work. So I have a bias, and I will be the first to admit it. Excuse me. Need a little coffee. Probably don't need any more coffee, actually. But I think it's a conversation, and it's an open conversation, and that's what I started with, having an open dialogue with your customer. And for customers, having an open dialogue with the tile setter, you can ask me any question, and I'm going to answer it honestly. I have a question here. I'm just going to look real quick. Oh, yes. Thank you for my fingernails. Yes, we can acknowledge that I do have light blue fingernails. I have a 9-year-old daughter, and this is what happens when you're stuck in the house all weekend and your daughter has some nail polish. So I think they bring out the blue in my eyes. Wouldn't you agree? So thank you for pointing that out. So moving through my list, what steps a homeowner can take to ensure their tile is installed properly? And as a tile setter starting out, I didn't know what I didn't know. I learned along the way. We all do that to a certain degree if we haven't been formally trained in the union. But I was starved for information, and there is a ton of information out there for both the homeowner and the tile setter. And with the advent of the internet, all that information is available online. And I will say that homeowners are often have a very high level of understanding of what needs to take place on their job because they buy a certain product and then they go on the internet, they find the installation instructions, they read them, and then you show up as a tile setter and they have a lot of information. So I showed up on those jobs where they had read the installation instructions before I had because I didn't know what I was bidding. But often there are manufacturers who have that information available for the tile setter and for the homeowner. So I think it's a good idea for everybody to educate themselves prior to the job starting. And I obviously, have been on the technical side of the business for 15, 16 years, and I've answered thousands of telephone calls as a manufacturer's representative on the technical side of the business where we have to have the conversation where, unfortunately, the tile setter did not read the installation instructions. And so there's a ton of information out there available for everybody, and educating yourself prior to bidding the work, prior to contracting with the tile setter is a good idea because it's much better if we're all on the same page and have a clear understanding of what's going to happen. So I could go on and on about that and talk about the value of installation instructions. And I think it's one thing that as a manufacturer is really important is to have technical services available for the homeowner and for the tile setter. So I think that's a Enough about that, but there is information available, and the more education everybody has, the better off the job is going to turn out, because that's what our goal is. My goal is to give you a beautiful job and get paid well for it, and your job is to have a beautiful installation that you love for years. So that requires a little bit of work on both of our parts. Should the homeowner designer provide a layout? It depends. So I've had the range, right, where I've showed up and I've been showed the box of tile and this is what I need to install. And I've also had jobs where the designer stood with me for the entire installation and told me where each piece of tile wanted to go. I will tell you that costs more money because I can't go as fast. So if you want to have that level of involvement, just be prepared to pay a little bit more. And I think that, you know, I can't give you the one boilerplate response to that question. And it depends on the material I'm installing. If I'm installing 4x4 ceramic from Dow Tile, I don't need someone to help me with the layout. But if I'm installing $200 a piece handmade tile, I'm going to want some direction. But I, as a tile setter, I always started my installation, and after installing several pieces, I always had the homeowner or the designer sign off of it, on it. Because unfortunately, I've seen jobs where it's a second home, the tile setter installs the whole thing, the homeowner doesn't like it, and it has to get ripped out. And that's not good for anybody. So that's something I would seriously consider as a homeowner, is checking in once the tile installation starts, which is the next question on my list, is how much check-in is too much check-in? And, you know, standing and watching me work, that's too much check-in. Like, I don't really like someone looking over my shoulder while I'm working, because regardless of why you're doing it, it feels like someone's kind of, you know, checking up on you. And I'm the qualified labor. I'm there to give you a good job. I don't need you commenting. But I do like to show you what I've done throughout the day. And occasionally, I may, hey, you want to come take a look at what I did? I always did that at the end of the day. That was my personal style. Checking in once or twice is okay. But standing there watching your tile setter work, no need for all that, because they know what they're doing. So they can give them a little bit of space to do the work. What are the homeowner's designer's responsibilities, and what are the tile setter's responsibilities? And that's a question that has to be a discussion between you as the homeowner or the designer and the tile setter. So the way I worked it is, if I did the takeoff on the job, if I did the count and provided that information to the point of purchase, then I was responsible for inspecting the tile upon delivery and making sure the count was accurate. If I ran out of tile, that was on me. The homeowner wanted to do the takeoff and wanted to order the tile and pay for it, they were responsible for the inspection, and they were responsible for the count being right. And it was actually in my contract, if I showed up to work and there wasn't enough tile, you got charged for the day because I can't go find another job to do. Did that ever happen? No, I never actually charged them, but that was kind of, that was in there because I needed that protection. I have to be, can't find something else to do at noon if I can't work on your job. So if you've got the day, you've got me for the day. So it kind of depends. We had that conversation because I made a little bit of money off the tile. You know, I got a better price, and, you know, that's what paid for my time and effort to do the takeoff. And I wasn't embarrassed to admit that. That's something, like, I'm there to make a living. So I think everybody does it differently. Some tile installers, they'll do the takeoff for free, and some won't. So it's you, as the homeowner, who have the contract to decide how you want to work. It's you have some decision to make there about what you're comfortable with. So 10:52, we're almost, because I started late, I want to get to all my questions today. I got them all. I went out of order. How much check-in is too much check-in? I already answered that. So that's kind of it. For in a nutshell for me today, talking about how to have a good working relationship with between the tile setter and the homeowner and or the designer. And I think it comes down to communication, being upfront with what your expectations are on the side of the homeowner, and same with me as a tile setter. Like, this is kind of, I need to establish what my expectations are with my customer as well. So good communication, and then utilizing your resources. And remember that not just me, but there are tons of tile out there. Tile manufacturers generally have a technical services department there to support both the homeowner and the tile setter. Thanks, Deli Belly's mama. Appreciate it. Thanks for being here. Thanks, everybody, for being here with me today on Tile Tuesday. And this is David Fatula from Island Stone signing off. See you next week.